Special event. We've got the gubernatorial candidates. We've got a couple of surrogates here who are going to speak on behalf of the gubernatorial candidates. But this really is an opportunity to provide you guys access to each of the candidates and being the millennials and what we've often talked about is a lot of times we feel like our voice is not heard, and that could be because our voter turnout rates aren't high, but we need to change that. But regardless, I encourage you guys to come out to the happy hours, to come out to the meetings, like our Facebook page. That's really the best ways to stay in touch. So one of, as president, the most proud elements I am of the organization is not only events like this and you guys coming out today, but is our board. And so I want today to provide an opportunity for each of our vice presidents to talk about what they're doing very briefly for the organization. I also want each of you guys to think about ways you can get involved, because we want more involvement, particularly on the GOP millennial side. And so if you hear one of the VPs speak and think, man, that's something I can help out with, that's something I'm passionate about, let us know. You know, we already have a very big board, but want to continue to grow that in very strategic ways. So first of all, Nick Carlson, who's our Vice President of Organizational Outreach, to come up and talk about what he's doing and the initiatives he's promoting. So go ahead, Nick.
Thank you, Jake. I'm going to going to try to take the brief remarks part to heart, but want to recognize the people who are involved in the outreach committee. We've got John Henry Theis over in the room. His wife, Stephen Theis, couldn't be here tonight. We have Rebecca Kemp, who also couldn't be here tonight. Lauren Mills is here somewhere. Lauren, thank you. And Ron Cato, where is Ron? See? Hey, Ron. Mixing around the room, trying to get to know you better. And if you're interested in membership or being more involved in the organization, each one of them would love to talk with you in a lot of ways, and they can introduce you to various things we do. Outreach is kind of a broad category, so we do a lot of different things. Helping out meetings is one of them. Another one is charitable events. We're working on organizing one right now, which we hope to be able to announce to you at the next meeting. Should be a good opportunity to volunteer in a community we aren't normally engaged with. Help bring our message to people. But hope you all have a wonderful time tonight. Thanks for coming.
Great. Thank you, Nick. Great job. So next up, I want to invite Gabe Hardwick, who's our VP of Membership, to talk about getting involved with AYR as an organization. I really think it provides an opportunity for each of you guys to join a movement, and I'll let Gabe talk about that a little further.
Membership, there is somebody I want to recognize who's been a huge asset to the club and to me personally. That's Sam Meyer. Sam has been our deputy VP of membership. He's helped us with a lot of stuff, and I do want to just let you guys know that he's moving to San Francisco. He just took a job out there. So unfortunate for me and for all of us, actually, because he has been such a huge help. So I just want to give Sam a big round of applause and to thank him for that. In just a couple moments, I want to say, why is it you become a member of the Nydeo Republicans? So first of all, you will be becoming a part of the largest YR chapter in the country, really in the world, I guess, if you think about it. And it costs money to run these events, run things like this, and so you're helping us do that. In addition to having access to all the networking and social events and things like that we run. So you're really helping out in that regard. Number two, you're getting, this year especially, you're going to be getting discounted membership or discounted rates to all of our social events. So that's not these events. We're not charging for the meetings on the Wednesdays, but when we have events coming up, like ones that Kevin is going to talk about here in a second, those will be discounted for members. And then finally, we're going to be bringing back the permanent name badges. So you guys may have figured out that we kind of have a code going on, red for Republican, those are for members, and then blue for non-members. You won't have to be walking around with the stick-on name badge if you're a member anymore. That's for lifetime members. You can become a yearly member as well for discounted rate, but lifetime members will get those permanent name badges. So that's all I've got to say. You can find me or Chelsea. Where's Chelsea? Chelsea, where you at? Chelsea's over here. If you want to become a member, we can sign you up after the meeting. We do take cash, credit card, debit, maybe Venmo too. So thanks.
Good job. Thank you so much, man. Great job. So now for our show, as I like to say, and in my opinion, the gubernatorial election in Georgia is at a very important stage. I think the Republican Party is weathering an attack by the media, nothing like we've ever seen in our lifetime as millennials. And if you look at it from the state of Georgia, all the talk that Georgia's purple, Georgia's going to be blue in the next 5 years. Well, in order to change that, in order to make sure that doesn't happen, in order to show that coming off of 8 years of a very successful Republican conservatism leadership, both in the governor's office and the legislature, we have to continue to get Republicans elected. And I think we're very fortunate to have a very strong slate of gubernatorial candidates this year, some of which are here to join us. Unfortunately, a couple of them could not join us, and so I told them that they could have their surrogates come give a 5-minute talk about really what their campaign is, what they're trying to push for. They're not going to be on the panel, but I do want to offer them an opportunity to speak. So Cody Hall is the first person. He's here on behalf of Hunter Hill. So go ahead, Cody.
Hey, everybody. And good evening. Thanks for having me, and thank you to Jake and the board for allowing some surrogates to speak on behalf of the candidates. Hunter is in Brunswick, Georgia this evening, and was yesterday as well, so he apologizes that he couldn't be able to make it out. I just want to share a couple of things about Hunter, for those of you who don't know him. He's a lifelong Georgian, grew up in Cobb County, chose to go to West Point and the U.S. Military Academy, graduated from there and chose to be an infantry officer. That brought him to beautiful Fort Benning, Georgia, in Columbus, where he graduated from Airborne and U.S. Army Rangers schools, and then led five different teams on three combat tours in Iraq and Afghanistan during those wars. After his third tour, he came home and started a business and started a family. He was involved in real estate for a while, and is currently the president of Tommy Newberry Coaching, which is an entrepreneurial coaching company that helps entrepreneurs and business people reach their full potential. He's also been in the state senate for 5 years, was first elected in 2012, and then resigned his seat last year to pursue the office of governor full-time. Hunter's vision for Georgia is really about implementing a more limited and focused government that delivers results for taxpayers. And really for Hunter that means three things. Number one, he believes that Georgia should eliminate our state personal income tax. That would put us on par with Tennessee, Texas, Florida, states that surround us but also compete with us for economic development. And number two, he believes we should double our investment in transportation, but do so without raising taxes. He fought to do that in 2015 and voted no on the tax increase for transportation. We all sat in the traffic to get here this evening, so we know how important that issue is to the future of our state. Thirdly, he's probably the most pro-school choice candidate in this race. He fought in the state senate for education savings accounts, which would allow the dollar to follow the child and allow that parent to choose how and where their child is educated. And he would lead in the same way as governor. So I've touched briefly on his bio. One thing on policy, I would encourage you to try the Hunter Hill IPA here at Five Seasons Brewery. No one tell Hunter, but it's not exactly my favorite that I've tried, but it's good, so I encourage you to try that. That was a result of Hunter's championing of SB 63, which was the beer jobs bill that opened the way for small brewers to sell directly to the public. So I mentioned those two things, and I want to touch on a quick thing that Jake mentioned about Georgia potentially turning purple and being in the crosshairs of the Democrats this November. I think that leads to two questions everyone in this room has to ask themselves. Number one, does this candidate believe the same way I do? Do they believe in less government, less taxes, and more freedom? Once I've answered that question, the second question is, can my candidate win? Hunter Hill was first elected in 2012, beating a Democratic incumbent in the most competitive state senate district in the state. In 2014, he was reelected. In 2016, Hillary Clinton won his district by 6 points, but Hunter won by 4. That's a 10-point advantage for Hunter running ahead of the ticket. So not only has Hunter campaigned, voted, and talked like a conservative and voted that way, but he also knows how to win elections and keep Georgia red in November. The governor's mansion is incredibly important. My last thing real quick, I would love for everyone here to join the team. You can reach out to me. I'm gonna be hanging around, so please come up to me. You can go to votehunterhill.com. And again, thank you for allowing me to speak real quick. Thanks.
Thank you, Cody. And anyone, Casey Cagle, surrogate. Okay, I know I talked to someone. I don't know if they came or not. Good, so now for our candidates. So, very briefly, we got Brian Kemp, Secretary of State. We got Marc Urbach here. And we got Representative Mike Williams. Clay Tippins indicated, he called me this afternoon, that he may or may not be able to make it. So I will leave his chair here in case he decides to come out. But the first question I have for each of you guys is, and I'll start with Brian. What is your vision for Georgia? You know, Georgia faces a lot of issues. In your opinion, what is the number one issue that Georgia faces, and how do we solve that issue? And we'll go Brian, Mark, and then Mike.
Well, first of all, let me just thank you all for coming out tonight, having such an unbelievable crowd out here. Really makes, I know, all of us feel good that you care enough to come out and hear about who's going to be your next governor, and it gives me even more hope and encouragement, like Cody said, about Georgia staying red. There's no doubt about that in my mind, as long as we have a good nominee. And I certainly want to be that nominee. I'd like to ask for your vote and your support. What drives me to run for governor is the same thing that drove me in the early 2000s running against a Democratic incumbent in a district that nobody thought I could win. It was because I was a small business owner, I was an entrepreneur, I was a father to three young daughters and a husband, and I just was simply frustrated with government. And I felt like we needed somebody that had that good common sense business person's mentality to go to the state house to do away with big, you know, Roy Barnes Democrat type ideas like drawing redistricting maps that go from Athens to Savannah, continuing to raise taxes, have big government policies. So I ran on cutting government red tape, on making taxes lower, making government more efficient. And that's exactly what I've been doing in the Secretary of State's office. And I know I don't have a long time to answer this question, so I will get on to the point, but I'm running for governor to put Georgians first, put you all first, ahead of the special interest, the status quo, the politically correct, and those that are here illegally. And to me, there's more than one big issue in this race. There are many. But I have a conservative four-point plan that will literally drive what I do as your governor. Make Georgia number one for small business, building off of the great things that Governor Deal and many other people, including the folks in our office, have worked hard to do, to fundamentally reform state government, the way we spend, tax, and operate, so that we can have real tax reform in Georgia, to make sure that no matter what your zip code or where you live, you have a good opportunity in our state to have access to things like high-speed internet, a good paying job, quality health care, those good qualities of life that make our state great. Not everyone has that. But the fourth thing is one I've already told you, that I want to put you first, ahead of those special interests in the status quo, the politically correct, and those that are here illegally. It's important that you have a governor that will literally stand up and fight for you every day ahead of those special interests. And I've got a record of doing that for myself and my family in the private sector, and also as Secretary of State, standing up to the left and those that do not believe in the ideals that we do, and simply doing the things that I told you I would do. And I'm looking forward to discussing more of that later this evening. So thank you for having me.
Well, good evening. Thank you so much for being here. It's always a pleasure speaking to fellow Republicans. And my name is Marc Urbach, a former teacher of Gwinnett County of 11 years. I've been here in Georgia for 18 years. Georgia citizens are the best in the nation, and Georgia is the best state in the nation. And that's a fact, because I've lived in many states. Before this, I was a small businessman in Austin, Texas. Raise your hand if you played youth leagues, baseball, soccer, football, anybody? Okay, so I was the one who did your individual team pictures in Austin, Texas for 9 years. I am a very morally upright person, okay? My profit for 6 to 8 years was about $6 to $8 a child, okay? But my sports leagues, they tripled the revenue with common sense business plans. I'm a common sense man, okay? I'm gonna use that for the rest of my life because I created my own media corporation, CSN, Common Sense News, Truth You Can Believe In. We're gonna reform CNN and transform Fox News. But the reason why I'm running for governor, I've said this for 9 months, since I've been a candidate for 9 months, I'm a statesman. And a statesman is a person running for elected office, and when they get in office, my oath to God, 10 million Georgians and our future children, our posterity, and two constitutions will be upheld at all times. Other people that are in elected office, they're career politicians, okay? And there's a huge difference. So why am I running for governor? Because I care about Georgians, okay, a lot. And we are in a spiritual battle, and we're also in a mental battle. Some Georgians care more about idol shows and Dancing with the Stars than their families, okay? I'm a master historian. I'm much more than a conservative. I'm a constitutional expert. And we know Georgians have the full right constitutionally to not follow anything that the Supreme Court decided underneath Barack Obama's term, example, the homosexual marriage case. That's an illegal decision. And as your governor, we are not gonna follow that illegal decision. That's one example of how I'm a constitutional expert, because we know the Supreme Court should never have heard it in the first place, okay? So again, I'm running for you and your families. And of course, some of you have never heard of me before, but it's not, like Seinfeld said, it's not me, it's the media. Currently, my attorney and I, we have the largest legal case in the history of Georgia right now, fighting for you and your families. These two know about it. Most of the General Assembly knows about it, and they're not doing anything about it. It's the Board of Regents General Assembly. I'm suing them to try to get the tens of millions of dollars back to your pockets, okay? So there's a clear choice for governor, and my basic philosophy is HHLR, health and happiness, love and respect. If we can change the hearts and minds of Georgians, if we can do that, that's the first step. Because like I said, we're in a battle for the hearts and minds of all Georgians, because Jake is right, the Democrats are going to push hard, okay? They're going to control the media. And believe me, they won't even say my name for 9 months, except the small papers have written about me. Because we work with the good, okay? We pray for all. And we will succeed, okay? We will keep Georgia red. We will stay a Republicanism state of inalienable rights, of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Because if we don't get those God-given rights back, then we're kind of just wasting our time. So I look forward to all of your questions. Thank you so much again for being here. And may God bless you and your families. Thank you so much.
I always enjoy following Marc Urbach. First of all, I just want to say how honored I am to be here. A couple of months ago, I was at UGA at the largest college Republicans organization in the entire country. Now, I'm at the largest young Republicans organization in the country, so it's exciting to be here. I also want to recognize my wife, Virginia. She's in the way back with little Brittany, a 9-month-old, and then also my oldest son, Aaron, who's joining me today. It's always a pleasure to have done this. What I would like to do before I answer the question is, first of all, tell you a little bit about myself, why I got involved in politics, and why I believe the answer to the question. First of all, I am a CPA, a small business owner. I got involved in politics in 2014, primarily because I was sick and tired of government regulations. I owned 18 Sport Clips haircuts locations, kind of ESPN used to barbershop. I had 160 employees. Obamacare came into play, and I didn't see how my small business would survive under the weight of Obamacare. So out of frustration again with government, I ran against a long-time entrenched Republican incumbent. He had the backing of Casey Cagle, he had the backing of the Georgia Chamber of Commerce. They put over $500,000 in the race to defend his seat. My wife, my kids, myself went out there. We knocked on over 20,000 doors. I put in over $300,000 of my own dollars into this race, and we beat the established Republican 66-34%. I was excited. I thought, I'm finally gonna have a chance, go down the Capitol and make a difference. What I learned really quickly, though, was that we, the people of Georgia, are not represented in our state government. It's the lobbyists, the special interest, and the wealthy elite. The biggest concern, the biggest issue that I see that we have for our state is lack of leadership. We have had a Republican-controlled governor's office, House and Senate for over a decade, but yet we still have some of the highest income taxes in the Southeast. We still have some of the worst schools in the country. Where are our Republican leaders that are actually standing up and fighting for our Republican values? They're too scared to fight the media and oftentimes even members of their own party. You need somebody that is not going to be scared to stand up for what we believe as conservatives. The very first time I was in this building, it was in February of 2016. It was another forum, it was a presidential forum. We had Josh McCoon here who was representing Ted Cruz. We had somebody else who was representing Marco Rubio. And I came representing Donald Trump. I found out, I was excited. I was the first elected official in Georgia to come out and endorse Donald Trump back in September of 2015. And I was excited to come out and have an opportunity to kind of share why I was supporting him with the group here. And I found out real quickly that they really weren't concerned with what I had to say. They just actually wanted to see somebody that supported Donald Trump. I was a bit of a novelty, but nonetheless, I stood up for what I believed in. I helped Donald Trump get elected, and we've seen what he's been able to do. And we need somebody that understands what our president's doing, can take that fight to the state capitol, and that's what I'm willing to do. Thank you.
Thanks, Andrew. So So for each of the responses, 5 minutes. I forgot to say this at the beginning. Nick will give a 1 minute warning whenever you guys are approaching the 5 minute mark. And so the next question is, what did you guys hit on, which is a state income tax? You know, you look at our bordering states, and most of them don't have a state income tax. There's been a lot of talk about it's not possible to eradicate the state income tax, yet we have a $2.4 billion reserve fund. So, and we'll start with Brian again to talk about, would you attempt to eradicate the state income tax? If not, why not, and how would you go about doing it?
Well, again, I'm going to go back to my conservative four-point plan. And I think it's important for you all because, look, we're talking to an educated audience. I mean, y'all are involved in politics. You're successful young people that are working in our working world today, and or you're well-educated or still getting that well education that I know that you will. So I'm going to be realistic with you. You know, I have no issues lowering the state income tax. I'm very supportive of doing that, but everybody in the race that's been talking about that, nothing has been done yet until this year after the Trump tax cuts. So what happened this year, we can actually thank the president for doing that, which created the windfall at the state that has triggered the tax bill. But that's why the day I announced my plan was to fundamentally reform how state government spends, taxes, and operates. Because I've been in the legislature, I've been back home, and when I ran for Secretary of State, knowing how the legislature works, I simply told people, I'm gonna tell people what I'm gonna do, and when I get in office, I'm gonna do it. So what I'm gonna do is implement a spending cap that's tied to population and inflation. So we're in good times like we're in now, we can budget conservatively, fund the things that we need to fund in state government, like transportation, education, health care, public safety, and so on. But you budget conservatively, and because we have that rainy day fund that will preserve our AAA bond rating, then you can continue to do real tax reform every single year when the economy's good. And that is a plan that you can believe in. You know, I'm not opposed to getting rid of the state income tax. I mean, everybody's for that, right? The question is, how do you pay for it? How much is it going to cost, and who's going to pay for it? It's $12 billion a year. In a $26 billion budget, where are you going to get that money from? You know, what are you going to cut to do that? Not that we can't cut government. I believe that we can. But to me, we need to start with a real-world solution of implementing the spending cap, budget conservatively, and then like this year, because of the Trump tax cuts, you can start lowering the rates every single year, or increase the deductions, or, you know, whatever it is. But I want tax breaks for everyone. The only people that have been getting this tax breaks up until this year have been the special interest groups. So I want to have broad-based tax reform that helps you all, working Georgians and Georgia families, and that is what I will do as your governor.
Great guy.
Well, this is a very important question because this is why most people have a job, to earn the fruits of your labor, to get that money and do whatever you want with it. When I was in community college in Orlando, Florida, and I transferred to, don't hold this against me, because I don't lie, I'm only half a Gator. That means only 2 years of Florida, but believe me, I'm all Dog and Yellow Jacket and KSU, and I'm also a Black Panther. I got my Master's of Education there. But seriously, we believe in keeping the fruits of our labor. That means you keep your money that you've earned. I am sick and tired of Georgians losing upwards of 55 to 65 cents on the dollar. The past five years, all the friends that I've made after I left teaching are either righteous Christians like myself, or righteous other religions, Jews, and a couple Muslims that are friends with, and veterans. And they've all lost about 55 to 65 cents on the dollar their lives. They can't take care of their grandchildren. So I am common sense, very, very much a conservative. I want you to keep the fruits of your labor. And if we go to a no income tax, we have to figure out, like Brian said, we have to figure out how we're gonna fund all the government. The problem with government, it's so massively bloated. I'm the only one that's trying to drain the swamp. Just like President Trump is draining the swamp in D.C., my legal case, if my attorney and I get to the grand jury, which is the fourth branch of government, because I started with Justice Antonin Scalia, his private writings, okay? We will not only just drain the swamp, we're gonna clean it. And a lot of DAs and judges could go to jail, and that's why the press won't say my name. So back to taxes and common sense philosophy. You deserve to keep the profits, the fruits of your labor, unless you just wanna give it to the bloated government, career politicians wasting your money. It's not right, it's not fair. So we have to sit down with the experts, whether we go with a fair tax or a consumption tax or something in between, to provide the necessary revenue to pay for an out-of-control government. So I want you to keep the fruits of your labor. You control your life, because again, common sense and very conservative principles. You know, you might not know this, when they first started taxing citizens with the income tax, what was it, Brian? It was only like 1% of a person's salary, and now it was up to 41 and Trump lowered it. So let's get it right here, folks. If you believe in keeping the fruits of your labor, if you believe in keeping your money, then you guys pressure the representatives. They're supposed to represent us. Some of them represent the special interests, okay? Time's up or not? All right, so I have 30 seconds? Okay, so last thing I'm gonna say. This is not rocket science. There's something called the multiplier effect. Every time a person keeps their money, they're either gonna do something with it. They're either gonna invest it, possibly in the stock market, okay, or they're gonna spend it, and that's called the multiplier effect. The problem with what's happened in Georgia, citizens are putting in Republicans, and then they turn into oligarchs in the government, and they've sucked up our money too much. So we need to get the money back into your pockets so you can spend it and the economy will rock and roll. So as your governor, I will do everything I can for you to keep the fruits of your labor. Thank you so much.
I guess let me start out by saying I am the only CPA in this governor's ranks. And if you want somebody that can actually tackle the budget, can actually reduce costs and expenses, I'm your guy. First of all, I absolutely believe that we can eliminate our state income tax, and I'll explain to you why here in just a little bit. But before that, I want to kind of interpret something to you about what Brian Kemp said. He talks about putting a spending cap in, but pegging it to population and inflation growth. What that basically means is he is going to continue spending at the current rate. We do not need to do that. We actually need to reduce our expenses, actually reduce the size of government. Several ways in which we can actually reduce the income tax is one, there is billions of dollars of waste in state government. Again, I'm an accountant. I actually enjoy reading audit reports and financial statements. I know it sounds kind of crazy, but I read them. And in reading them, I found several different areas in the state where we are wasting money. One example is the Department of Corrections. They spent $33 million a couple years ago. They booked it into an account called Construction in Progress, makes this asset out there that will have some future value. Audit came in and said, where is this asset? They couldn't find it. They said, okay, well, where's the invoices? Where's the receipts that the money was spent for? They couldn't provide any proof of where this $33 million went. That's bad enough, but nobody was held accountable. Nobody was fired. There was no article about in the AJC. It just was swept under the rug. As your governor, you better believe people will be fired and changes will be made. There was another report that came out just a couple of weeks ago where Department of DCH transferred over $130 million to Department of DHS. DHS only received about $105. That's $15 million. Where'd $15 million go? So again, I can dive into these areas of policy into these agencies and figure out how we can start to reduce the spending and have better accountability for the money. Also, tax credits. The state of Georgia gives out all kinds of tax credits. We read in the media, politicians love to say how Georgia is the number one state in the country to do business. As I've traveled this state, I've asked small business owners, do they feel like Georgia's the number one state in the country to do business? I've yet to find one. The reason Georgia has that title is because of the tax credits that we give to large corporations. Just last session, there was over $500 million of tax credits that were going to go to corporations. We cut out tax credits, we reduced spending, and then we also transitioned over to a fair tax model where we're actually taxing consumption, not income. We can eliminate the state income tax.
Thank you. Mike actually just hit on my next question, which is coming off of Governor Deal's administration, Georgia now for 5 consecutive years has been voted the number one place to do business. And great results, there's no doubt about it. But the reality is, in a way, Republicans have to balance that with maintaining the values and the religious principles on which the Republican Party in both the United States of America are based upon. And so, briefly, we're going to go 2 minutes on this one, Mike, because you hit on this a lot. But as a Republican, how do you balance continuing to bring in the big corporations which create jobs, which increase the GDP in Georgia, while maintaining the Republican principles that the party was based on?
Basically, what we have to do is, first of all, stop giving billions of dollars in tax credits to corporations that want to come into our state and fight our values. Amazon. I love Amazon. My wife, she loves Amazon Prime now. She orders it, it comes like 2 hours. It's absolutely fabulous. But to give Amazon $10 billion, $9 billion for them to come in and fight what we believe in, it's counterproductive. And when you look at all the big companies that have come to Georgia, whether it's Caterpillar, whether it's Mercedes, Gulfstream, go and look at Casey Cagle's financial disclosures. I haven't actually looked at Brian's yet, but Casey Cagle's, I know. He's
I haven't looked at yours either.
He hasn't even filed any, so we don't know where he's going to get his money from. He's got tens of thousands of dollars from those companies, so these politicians are giving our tax dollars to large corporations that come in and fight our values for kickbacks on the campaign side. What we have to do is eliminate our state income tax. I was reading a Forbes article not too long ago, and they questioned the top CEOs around the country. Where do they want to relocate their businesses? Florida and Texas were number one and number two. Both of those have no state income tax. We have to create an environment where, again, the tax regulations as well as general regulations are business friendly, where businesses want to come in because they see what Georgia has to offer and not because we're bothering them with paybacks.
You're off.
As your governor, my team believes, and I believe, that it's not the governor's responsibility to pick winners or losers when it comes to corporations that are so massively large, financially powerful in terms of campaigns with how they can influence. It's not fair to the average Georgian, it's not fair to small businessmen, small businesswomen, and it's not the right thing to do. So my office is not going to pick winners or losers, but this is kind of like a double-edged sword. We know that Georgia is number one for business for many reasons. And in life, there's everything, there's good and bad. It's good that we have these large corporations here because the salaries for many people are high salaries. And I'm determined to keep Georgians making high salaries, okay? But we also have a massive traffic problem in the city, which most of you know about, okay? A massive problem. And if you think the traffic's bad now, in 5 years, it could get 40, 45% much worse in your drive time. So it's a balancing act. I do not favor giving Amazon billions of our dollars. Jeff Bezos, believe me, it's worth $115 billion now. Who knows what it'll be worth at the end of the year, okay? What we need to do is dramatically cut the size of government, inspire citizens, men and women, to start their own businesses, because small businesses are the life cycle of every town, city, and state in this nation, okay? Would I like Amazon to come? Sure, they can pay their own way. Because when they get the 50,000 employees, who's going to pay for all that schooling and transportation for all those employees? So it's a double-edged sword. And as your governor, we, the citizens, are going to look at full transparency. Like Michael said, everything's on the computer. Everything that he said Casey did, which I don't know, is on the computer. Every one of these citizens, including myself, we can get that information with open records requests. And that's what the citizens need to do. So as your governor, we will work together and we will decide together which corporations come to influence our Georgia's economy. Thank you so much.
let me just say this, that I'm no accountant, but I've been a small business owner. I've been a small business owner for every day I've ever served in elected office for over 30 years straight, and that includes today. And I pay a lot of money every year to accountants to do our tax returns, so I have great respect for accountants. But I can assure you, my spending cap is not going to be tied to the growth that we've seen in government, going from $19 billion up to $26 billion since the start of the recession. My spending cap would prevent something like that from happening, where we could have done tax reform before this year. To answer the question about where we do next and how do we preserve our values, look, we're a great state. We have great people. We have great educational, especially higher educational institutions. We got a great workforce. That's why people want to come here. It's a great place to live, work, play, and raise your family. And I know that because I've been doing that for over 30 years in the private sector. To me, the next step for the state of Georgia is building off being number one for business, building off of the great energy that we have in our state, and making us number one for small business. We do that by taking a chainsaw to government regulations, just like we've done in the Secretary of State's office, making our office more efficient through technology and through smaller government. I'm the only person in the race that's run an executive branch agency that even knows how to do all that. And I have a good record of doing it. If I had more time, I would tell you about some of the great things that we've done. But that's how we keep Georgia moving forward, where you all have good opportunities going forward. But we do not have to change our Georgia values to recruit companies to our state. They want to come to our state because of our values. We need to preserve those, and I will do that as your governor.
So one of the big issues facing America right now is guns, the Second Amendment shooting. And I know each of these individuals have spoke on this, but I think it's an important opportunity for them to voice to us what their position is. And if you listen to the media, these shootings are 100% about guns, caused by guns. But the reality is bad people are going to do bad things, and they're going to find a way to do them, whether it be bombs, machetes, guns, knives. And so taking guns away from the good people to defend against the bad people probably isn't the best idea in the world. Now, I may have answered the question for you guys in a way.
We agree with you.
But we also all want to maintain the protections of schools, of kids, of large vicinity areas such as stadiums. So how do we balance that? And then I think the more important question, I think, as Republicans we all have to face is how do we overcome the onslaught of the media controlling the rhetoric that currently exists in the United States? So Brian, I'll let you start.
Well, I've certainly been a strong supporter of the Second Amendment for a very long time. My voting record speaks to that. I shoot, I hunt, I carry. The tragedy that we have seen is just, I mean, how do you even understand how somebody would do that to a classroom full of kids? But the real fact of the matter is that individual had to pull that trigger. But he could have just as well driven a car into a, you know, people walking out in the parking lot. It could have been a bomb. It could have been a shotgun versus, you know, some other type of firearm. So I think we definitely need to work with our local communities. I believe in local control. I think that's up to the schools, the school board members, local law enforcement, to make sure that their schools are secure. I certainly see that, you know, the state being involved in that if we're asked, but I don't think that needs to be a mandate to do that. But literally, when you're sitting in Tommy's barber shop in the same shopping center as the OK Cafe, and you have a police officer telling you that in the last 2 weeks there's been three women dragged out of their car and their vehicle stolen in broad daylight, people have to have the ability to defend themselves. In my hometown of Athens, there's been 12 drive-by shootings in like the last month. So we have a crime problem here. And we have to give the abilities, the citizens the ability to arm and protect themselves within the law. And I think as Republicans and leaders in our state, and certainly the governor will be one of those key leaders in the state, we've got to get our message out to be compassionate to these issues on mental health and what else can we be doing in those instances. But we've also got to have our people in our community stepping up to talk more and to report these kind of things so local law enforcement can actually do their job. It is no, you know, silver bullet on this type of issue. And it's unfortunate that a lot of people on the left and certainly the media use this as a wedge issue, and a former Supreme Court justice talking about repealing the Second Amendment. I mean, that's the craziest thing I've ever heard of. If anything should drive conservatives out to vote, it's protecting our constitutional amendments and our constitution in this country and the right for people to protect and defend themselves. And I will certainly be a governor that will stand up and do that.
Well, our gun rights are God-given. They're inalienable rights in the Bill of Rights. And I support the NRA. I'm an NRA member. And I believe that Team Urbach, many of my friends on the team and myself, we believe in constitutional carry. What that means is any gun that a police officer is allowed to have, citizens of Georgia should have that same weapon, at least the opportunity. That's constitutional carry. Okay, so ask yourself this question. From 1955 to 1985 is 30 years. How many school shootings were there in America? Probably a tiny, tiny number. So the question is, why so many the past 20 years? It's a very legitimate question. And the main answer is, if you believe in constitutional principles and conservative principles, we know the person's heart, mind, and soul controls the hand that reaches for the gun and commits the murder. It's not the gun. The media will never say that. No one will ever say that. I'll say it again. It's a person's heart, mind, and soul that forces the hand that takes the gun and commits murder. Okay? So it's not the gun, it's not the problem. Okay? It's what the Supreme Court did the past 60 years by removing God and freedom of religion from the schools, which I'm an expert on and I wrote my book. Okay? So let's get our schools right. And how do we get our schools right? It's common sense. There's thousands of volunteers around the school, and there's thousands of veterans that live around the school. Well, the school is four walls with a couple doors and entrances. So you get volunteers to staff the doors. And if the citizens in the counties want to raise their taxes to pay for these people, to man the position for 7 hours, so be it. As your governor, this is a problem that we can solve with common sense principles. Because like Brian said, I believe every Georgian, if they have the mental aptitude to buy a gun and carry it, they should do so to protect themselves and their families against this wicked amount of crime in our towns, cities, in our state. The crime is out of control. Okay, so we need, as the Republicans who believes in Republicanism principles, we need to start setting the seeds in people's minds and telling them enough of this nonsense of crime and murder in our schools, towns, and states. And as your governor, we will enforce the Second Amendment here in Georgia. Thank you.
I am a huge advocate for the Second Amendment right, and I am so proud of my son back there, Ammon. He actually built his own 9mm pistol. I was excited for that. I was a little concerned, though. I wanted to know who the first person was going to be to shoot it, but very proud of him for doing that. Also, I was the first candidate for governor that came out in full support of constitutional carry. I also have a bill as the second signer to in the Senate that pushes that forward. After the shootings down in South Florida, we came up with a school safety program. We announced it about a week or so after that, which would allow teachers that want to carry. It doesn't force any teacher to carry. It only allows those that want to carry so they can protect their students. And those students, their faculty or staff that want to carry on campus in the schools, there's training requirements they'd have to go through. One of them is the carry permit, as well as something called post certification. That's very similar to the training that police officers have that we see every day that they go around and protect us. So we'd have our schools protect from the inside. Then also, every open door to the school that's unlocked, there would be a plain clothed armed officer there. And we saw in Maryland a few weeks back where an armed official actually saved the lives of who knows how many students because he was able to take out a perpetrator. We don't need to infringe upon our Second Amendment rights, but we do need to protect our children while they're at school. And the way to do that is not to have a gun-free zone, but to make sure that people there are prepared and ready to protect our kids. Last thing. This question is, how do we fight the media? It goes back to my very first statement as far as we need to have strong leaders that are willing to take stands to fight the media, and I would do that as well.
I'm going to have two more questions, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. So we're going to have to be selective in the questions. So what I'm going to do is, if you have a question, talk to Janelle and tell Janelle your question, because that way we're not going to have 50 million questions. So 2 minutes and answer on the next two. That way we can get the audience an opportunity to talk. The next question is, and we talked earlier about Georgia's rainy day fund. And for those of you that don't know, currently Georgia, in my opinion, by virtue of fiscal conservatism, has over $2 billion in a reserve fund. Georgia also faces a lot of issues: infrastructure, the opioid epidemic, sex trafficking. So going forward, and we'll start with you, Brian, what should the money be used to do? Should the money not be used at all? Should it be used to go back to the taxpayers?
Well, I think we've got to have a healthy rainy day fund to protect our AAA bond rating, which really decides basically what the state's interest rate is when it's borrowing money to do construction projects and other things. So having a strong credit rating is a good thing for our state. And being in state government, when we've had budget shortfalls before, where, you know, I voted against tax increases to balance the budget, we spent weeks cutting budgets when the Republicans first got in the majority, when we didn't really know where all the bodies were buried in that first year of Sonny Perdue. You know, you saw the reserve when Governor Deal came into office go down to like $100 million or $50 million. It was nothing. So it's important that we have that. So if we have another, you know, really catastrophic event like we had during the Obama recession, we could weather that. That being said, the way our state is growing, we're going to continue to have excess revenues if we budget conservatively, which will give you the money along with, you know, cutting wasteful spending and really clamping down and implementing a spending cap to where you can continue to do real tax reform. So that, to me, is what we need to be doing. But it also will allow you to fund the priorities that we have in state government. I mean, I will be a governor, and I can't tell you how many times I've said this on the campaign trail, but I will be a governor that asks, how much does it cost? Who's going to pay for it? And do we have a good return on investment for that? Because there's been things that we've been spending money on in state government that we don't have a lot to show for. Some of the tax credits is a good example of that. So that's where the whole second part of my common sense plan comes in, to fundamentally reform how state government spends, taxes, and operates. To me, it all starts there.
Is very, very important that we keep the money in the fund to keep our AAA bond rating. That's common sense and that's necessary. Okay, but we need to inspire citizens that are Republicanism principles and Republicans, inspire them to realize that you guys are the first branch of government. Our Constitution starts with the Declaration of Independence, the consent of the governed. The representatives are supposed to represent you, the people, not the special interests. You have a say in what happens with these billions of dollars in the slush fund, okay? We, here at Team Urbach, we want citizens to have their say, and we want to hear from you. I want you to call our office and email our office what you want from your government, because that's not what has been happening. These career politicians and fake conservatives have bloated the government from $15 billion to $26 billion of a budget. Okay, and the massive financial corruption, the billions of dollars, is something I've never seen before. But when you run for elected office, like I've done here for governor, as a candidate for the past 9 months, in my legal things that I'm doing, it's holy cow, is this government way out of control, and they're robbing you of your money. okay? So you guys have a say in what happens with your government, because you are the first branch of government, okay? And that's in the Georgia Constitution, we the people. I want to hear from you. You should demand this from the representatives. Do not let them continue to oppress and abuse you, because it's not fair. And as your governor, I will be fully, completely, and as I've been, fully transparent with you in every dollar that is in the budget, in every dollar that is in the surplus, you will see, because it's already there on the computers. And that's my pledge to you. Thank you.
First of all, I do believe it's very conservative and very necessary to have a rainy day fund. That's basically a savings account for the state. And that number is actually now approaching the $4 billion mark. It's important, though, to note that that is not just $4 billion sitting in an account somewhere in the savings account. Really what it is it's just a line item on the balance sheet that says through the appropriations process we have extra money that we can spend, because that cash is actually in out there being used someplace else. So I think we do need to have that. I think the underlying question behind your question was, should we be spending it someplace else as opposed to having it in the rainy day fund? And I don't. I think there's other areas within the budget that we can cut to make sure that we get a better return on the investment and the citizens are seeing more value. Education, for an example. Now, we all know that we need to improve education here in the state of Georgia. And when you go through and you look at where the money is being spent in education, the vast majority of it, at least disproportionately, is not in the classroom. It's in the administrative level of education. We need to shrink that administrative level of education and actually give teachers more money in their pay raises, as well as more money they can use to actually educate our students. So I know very strongly that we can solve so many of the state's problems, whether it's education, transportation, rural broadband, whatever the problem is, we can solve it. We just had somebody at the governor's office actually understood finances, understood where the money was going, how it was being spent, and could make sure that we are utilizing it properly.
All right, last question for me, then we're going to open it up. 1 minute answers.
1 minute.
Is Donald Trump good or bad for the Republican Party? Mark, we'll start with you.
The answer is yes, because if the media would show you the truth of all the great things he's doing, okay, then you would be going, holy cow, he is really draining the swamp, okay? And that's the truth. So he's doing so many incredibly great, good things, but the media won't say what he's doing, okay? Is he perfect? No, he's not perfect, okay? But he's doing remarkable good things for the nation, the likes I've never seen before, okay? But he's a man, and he goes a little bit too much on his Twittering, okay? So he knows that, but he's doing it on purpose to rile up the media, okay? Because they will not say all the good things he's doing, okay? But I believe in Donald Trump. He's our CIC, our commander-in-chief, and as he drains the swamp in D.C., as your governor, I and my legal team, we will not only drain the swamp, but we'll clean the swamp. Okay, because my oath to you, some of the counties, time's up? Okay, time's up. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Again, being the first elected official in Georgia to come out and campaign and be a senator for Donald Trump, I absolutely know he is good for the Republican Party. But this is why. We see candidate after candidate after candidate that runs on the Republican ticket, that knows all the key words to say. They get elected and they go do something else. Donald Trump is making it harder and harder and harder for those candidates and those elected officials to continue that. He's calling them out and he's creating dilemmas where they're having to choose. Are you going to support the Republican values that you campaigned on, or are you going to show the people where you really believe? So I am absolutely in support of the president. He's doing a great job.
President's doing a great job. I think if you look compared to especially what we could have had with Hillary Clinton, there's no question I'm very glad that Donald Trump is our president. You look, don't count that against my time. But look, Neil Gorsuch being on the Supreme Court, I've been very critical of the Congress at times, but thank the Lord that the Senate rammed that nomination through and got Neil Gorsuch. on the Supreme Court. That is absolutely huge for the conservative movement. Literally, it will be for decades to come. Cutting government regulations, something that I have been talking about since day one of this gubernatorial campaign and doing since 2010 in the Secretary of State's office. I heard a person speak to, well, I guess it was Vice President Pence at the President's Day dinner, said, you know, they have the rule in the Trump administration for every government regulation that they create, they wanted to cut two. Well, Pence said the other night, for every government regulation they've created, they've cut 22. Those are the kind of things that Republicans need to be doing. And despite the media criticism, if Donald Trump will continue to do things that he said he was going to do when he was running, like building the wall and making sure that we have border security, and then we go after the criminal illegal aliens that are here, that are wreaking havoc in our drug cartels, then he will continue to get good marks with the people. And that is what matters. It doesn't matter what the media says about you. They've been railing against me for, you know, 8 years, and so has the left. What matters is us as leaders doing what we say, and if we do that, we will win at the ballot box.
So now we're going to open it up. Janelle, where'd she go? There she is. So Janelle's got the first, she's going to ask the question. She's going to say who, what the person's name is, and then we'll go right to left.
Okay. Do not butcher me or get me if I don't say it exactly how you wrote, okay? Thank you. All right. The first question is for each of the candidates, and this is from Chelsea. She said, I would like to know what is your plan on combating gun deaths of unarmed black men and the clear-cut-out racism on the judicial bench?
Woo! 2 minutes.
30 seconds.
30 seconds. Well, let me just say this. I wouldn't be able to speak about what's going on the bench because I've been very busy in my own world, protecting our elections and fighting the left in many of our elections. But one thing that I have seen is the only candidate in the race that has a law enforcement division under their purview. And I think anybody would tell you that when they're dealing with the Secretary of State's office, post-certified investigators, that we let the facts lead the way. And we will continue to do that. And that is what I will stress as your governor. But it's also one reason that we have come up with our plan to track and deport and create a criminal illegal alien database, because over 50% of our violent crimes, shootings, and murders are coming from gangs and those that are here illegally, this violent crime. And this database will give law enforcement the tools that they need to step up enforcement and be able to track and deport the illegals and go after these gangs that are creating these violent crimes, and that will be a priority in the Kemp administration.
Hey, did Brian not have that question? Did he not hear the question?
It's okay, he's good.
Because I wasn't asking about legal immigration.
But you were asking about racism.
Racism, yeah. Unarmed black men being shot, and judicial bias from the bench.
That's okay.
Well, I said that I wouldn't be able to speak to judicial bias from the bench.
Go ahead.
It's a very good question. It's a very important question. Please don't take what I'm going to say the wrong way. It's going to sound like something bad, but it's not. I am a racist, but I love black people, white people, brown people. The reason why I say that is because I love all people. I love all people. I use the words black, brown, and white. I use those words. The media doesn't like that. The media doesn't like our free speech. We know in Georgia there's poor black people, there's poor white people. No, I'm being very serious. The media doesn't allow these words, but I use my free speech. I love all people. Many of my friends are all different colors and religions. I don't care what the, you know, what colors thin they are. What I'm getting at is there's poor blacks in this state, there's poor whites in this state, there's poor browns in this state. And the question is a very good question. Why are so many African Americans, that's what the media calls them, on my team they're all Americans, why are they getting incarcerated or arrested so much? It's because of either what they're doing or the police are targeting them. There's a reason why they're getting arrested. I don't know the facts, I can send the reports, but we need to make sure the police are doing their job properly, okay? As your governor, I will enforce all due process rights. because I know that some people, black, white, and brown, are getting arrested and they're getting thrown in jail, and they should not be in jail. Their due process rights are being denied. Okay, so as your governor, we need to reach the hearts and minds of all people so they don't commit crimes in the first place. But the question is a legitimate question, and why are so many African Americans being incarcerated and arrested? I want to look at the data and the facts, because maybe the police are picking on them, and the police are not going to pick on any Georgia citizens under your Governor Urbach's watch. Thank you so much.
Like I said, I never know how to follow Marc Urbach. First of all, I actually want to compliment Nathan Deal, Governor Deal, because he has done a tremendous job on criminal justice reform here in the state of Georgia. We used to be down at the bottom, and we've made a lot of progress over his term as governor. One of the areas that I believe strongly that we can focus on is it is a crime in Georgia to be poor. What I mean by that is if you get a ticket and you are too poor that you can't pay that ticket in the state of Georgia, you're put on probation. You have to pay probation fees and fines and all this stuff because you're too poor to pay the ticket. So what would normally cost maybe $175, $200, $250 ends up costing two and three and four times that because you couldn't afford to pay the original balance to begin with. That is fundamentally and morally wrong. We have got to change that underneath my leadership. Also, I am probably the biggest advocate for marijuana, medical marijuana, here in the state of Georgia. We need to grow it, dispense it, and allow safe access for those who have it. And I know Atlanta is in the process of decriminalizing it, and I think we need to watch and see what happens there in Atlanta.
Okay, so for the sake of time, we're not going to get to all the questions, so I'm going to ask the questions that are specifically directed to one particular candidate. And yeah, if you can answer it in 1 minute, okay? Best of your ability. All right, Secretary Kemp, will you support a policy, and this is coming from Mamet? Yes. Okay, so his question is, will you support a policy that makes English the official language when doing government and business transactions in order to help support laws that are against English?
Well, I believe English is already the official language of our country and our state, so I certainly support that. Now, people that are here legally doing business with the state, I certainly don't have an issue having, business type forms and other things that are done in foreign language. I mean, I think that's when you're an international state and doing business at the international level, that makes sense to me. But when people are here as citizens, or if they become citizens, that's one reason I supported Senator Perdue's RAISE Act to really redo the whole immigration process. People need to learn English. They need to know that that's the official language, and that that's how we're going to operate in our country. So that's the way I feel about it.
Okay, and the last question was actually directed towards Mr. Williams. So this gentleman, is it Gary? Okay, so his question is, he said he's currently an undecided voter, and he is fiscally conservative, and he said, how will you stand up for social issues such as abortion, Planned Parenthood, and things of that nature when the big corporations and the dollars come in?
Well, again, I am a huge advocate for life. I am 100% pro-life. And the reason why I say that is little Brindley that my wife is holding back there. She was conceived through IVF. And I remember going to the doctor whenever my wife was impregnated. And I saw they did a ultrasound. When they stuck the tube inside of her, I saw this little dot shoot out of the tube and attach to the inside of my wife. We went back several weeks later, and that dot had a heartbeat. and that was little Brindley's heart beating. And yesterday, I proposed an amendment on the floor of the Senate to ban abortions once a heartbeat is detected. The amendment was not allowed to come to the floor for a vote in a Republican-controlled Senate. That to me is a shame. That to me is a sign of very, very weak leadership. This is a very basic fundamental right that that we have, the right to life, and a very basic value of the Republican Party. And for us not be able to vote on that, I think is a shame, and I'll fight for that to happen.
Okay, and our final question is for Mr. Urbach. For those who say you cannot win a general election, what do you say to them?
That's a very good question. First of all, I don't want to make sure there's any rumors out there. I love, because so many, all the students I taught for 11 years, white, blacks, and browns. Again, I believe in free speech. I use white, blacks, and browns. All my friends that are African-Americans, they know they're not African-Americans. They're all Americans, and they call themselves black. So I just want to make sure everyone's very clear. Okay, I told you, I preempted that as a little bit of a joke, babe. You know, I love all people. Doesn't matter what the skin color is. We're in the purpose of winning hearts and minds and souls, okay? For people that don't think I can win, they know nothing what I've done for 9 months. Some people just see me up here. They haven't even vetted me. They haven't even seen what I've done for 18 years here in Georgia. They have no concept of all the 20 hours a day that I put in the past 9 months. They have no idea that I put my fortune into to get to this point in my life, okay? I believe in what I'm doing, and God, if God wills it, I'll become your next governor. Of course it's difficult, there's no doubt about it. No doubt about it. But I believe in myself, I believe in my team, and I believe in righteous Georgians, and with God and Jesus Christ, all things are possible. So thank you so much.
Well, good, so let's give all the candidates a round of applause. For each of these guys, we're very lucky to have a great Republican gubernatorial slate, and these guys are working hard to keep Georgia red. So very quickly, I've got two brief announcements. The first, I want our VP of events to come up and talk about our upcoming events. I encourage each of you guys to come out.
Hey everyone, how's it going? Hope you enjoyed the debate tonight.
Great.
Well, there you go. We have our April happy hour down the street at public school 404. That's going to be April 12th, starting at 7 o'clock, ending to whenever you're ready to go home. And then also in May, we're doing an event at Sweetwater. More information is going to come off of that, but we're essentially going to get a room at the brewery, and we're going to have $10 for members, $40 for non-members. That's going to be on May 10th, and more information will come out for that as we get closer. But hope to see everyone at the events, and hope to see everyone at the April happy hour.
Thank you. And like Kevin just said, in May we're doing a big event at Sweetwater, so I encourage you guys to keep an eye out, like our Facebook page, and so you can keep notified of that. So Janelle Jones is our VP of Political Affairs. We'll give a brief statement about our meeting next month in April.
Okay, I'm going to be really, really brief. So thank you, Jake, for moderating. This was awesome. And thank you all for coming out. Yes, so next month we are, well, you know what, before I even do that, where is Chuck? Is Chuck here? Where's Chuck? There he is. So Chuck is my deputy. I love my Chuck. So he has worked really, really hard with getting our speakers in together. So as a VP of Political Affairs, that is my responsibility. My role is to make sure that we have good speakers and that our events are going smoothly and you're well informed. So next month, we are tackling the Second Amendment issue. We are working on getting speakers that are from the NRA side, those who support the NRA, and those who do not, because we like to have a balanced discussion. So please stay tuned for the details that we will put out in all of our invites. So, yeah, there we go. Thank you.
Great job, Janelle. And that meeting will be April 25th, so mark your calendars. With that, we're going to conclude. Each of my board members, please raise your hand. I want to give a shout out to all these people. They really are the lifeblood of the organization, and I could not do it without them. Stay, network, meet people, shake hands. If you have any questions, talk to the board members, and don't forget to meet the candidates. Thank you again for coming out today.
Appreciate it. Thank you.